Caroline does outline the vice principal of the graduate school at Montana Tech. It's my pleasure to welcome you to today's public lecture. We're really pleased to have with us Dr. Professor Dame Jocelyn Del Burnell from the United Kingdom, Oxford University, and the University of Dundee. Jocelyn has had a very distinguished career, which includes having discovered pulsars, but also being at least 1.5 terms the president of the Institute of Physics, which is the UK equivalent of the American Physical Society, and many other things. She's on a lot of advisory boards, and a month ago or so, not quite, it was announced that she was the winner of the second
fourth
Fundamental Physics Prize, which she has to go to California to collect in about a month.
Yeah.
But it's really a great pleasure to have her here with us at Montana Tech today to talk about women in astrophysics, a UK perspective, and add some extra spice of astrophysics, physics, and poetry. So, Jocelyn, it's a great pleasure to welcome you to Montana Tech.
Thank you very much. And thank you for the opportunity to visit here. It is my first visit to Montana, and I have been really struck by how beautiful it is. Also a lot more mountainous in this part than I had really appreciated, but a splendid opportunity to visit, and thank you all for coming this afternoon. I'm going to be talking under several different heads. I'm going to give a little bit of personal history as a woman in physics, a woman in astrophysics. I'll say a little bit about pulsars, the pulsating radio stars that I discovered as a grad student. And then a little bit about what I know about women in astronomy worldwide. And finally, some UK initiatives on women in science, technology, engineering, and maths, STEM. I think you use the same abbreviation here. Yeah. So, good, and the clicker's not working because I haven't turned it on. That's better. So in Britain, we had an important exam for school kids at age 11, which was to determine whether you had an academic career education or whether you were moving towards something more technical and were going to be taught some skills. I failed this exam. One of the reasons I subsequently discovered was there was a higher pass mark for girls than for boys, at least in my area. At age 11, girls are typically brighter than boys, and too many girls were passing this exam, squeezing too many boys out of this academic educational stream. And everybody knew that women were only going to get married, have families, and not be part of the workforce. So it was much more important to educate the boys, wasn't it? But the girls were squeezing the boys out of this stream, so the way they solved the problem was to have a higher pass mark for the girls. My education up to the age of 11 had been in the what we call the primary part of the school that I would carry on into, and parents had some influence with the head teacher. It was a small town, after all. And I got put in the academic stream, even though I'd failed this exam. But one of the first things that happened as we entered this senior school is on the Wednesday of the first week of the first term, a message went round the class. First year boys this afternoon to such and such a room. First year girls this afternoon to some other room. And my first thought was, this is sport. That's why they're separating us. It wasn't sport. They sent the boys to the science lab and the girls to what they had the cheek to call domestic science. Needlework, cookery, housekeeping, etc. I had been promised by my parents that I'd get to do some science in secondary school, so I was upset, but the teacher in domestic science wasn't hearing of any change. But once again, my parents stepped in, phoned the head teacher, and so did the local doctor who had a daughter in my class, and so did one other set of parents. And the second time the science class met, there were three girls and all the boys. And the teacher made us three girls sit right under his nose, right abutting his desk, because clearly we were dynamite, troublemakers, I don't know what. The first term we did physics, and I found it easy. And I came top of the exam, surpassing all the kids who got through that 11 plus exam. So much for the 11 plus. The next term we did chemistry, that was okay by me. The third term we did what they called biology, which meant they gave us flowers, it was summertime by then, flowers to draw, label the parts and learn the names. I thought, boring. And I've had a bit of a prejudice against biology ever since. So again, you know, your early schooling has an awful lot of influence on you. This was all in a small town in Northern Ireland, which is highly sectarian, really, really prejudiced, very, very narrow. I was in a community which was scared of science because they were afraid it would contradict the Bible. And my parents had decided that we would all have some of our education out of this little province, Northern Ireland, in mainland England, Britain, if you wish. So I went away to a Quaker girls' boarding school in York. Girls' boarding schools at that time had problems getting good science teachers. But I have to say our physics teacher was absolutely brilliant. And there was at least one good maths teacher. And I did, for school leaving, maths, further maths and physics. I thought my Quaker girls' boarding school was a little bit sheltered. So vowed when I went to university to go to somewhere a bit more real world. I chose Glasgow University. This had been a shipbuilding city, well, a large industrial city. The industry was declining fast and it was actually getting quite rough. So I think I overdid it slightly in going to Glasgow. So the system in Glasgow University was to admit into the first year everybody who met the minimum qualifications, to give them a chance at higher education, which I think was probably right, but it did mean that something like one third of the class was thrown out at the end of the first year. And it felt a little bit like a survival game. I was determined to do physics, but there weren't many women doing physics. And for the junior and honour seniors year, I was the only female in a class of 50, 49 men and me. And it was the tradition, in inverted commas, in Glasgow at that time, that when a woman entered the lecture halls, and stamping and whistling and catcalling, making as much noise as you could by the gentleman. And for my final 2 years, I had to face that on my own. It was mostly good-natured, but I did once come top in a subsidiary maths exam, which I had worked for and they hadn't. And I was really a bit scared on that occasion. I'm not too cross with my fellow students. They were only doing what other students had told them students did. But I'm still really rather angry with the faculty, who must have known exactly what was going on because of the volume of noise. And nobody attempted to stop it. Indeed, one or two of them smirked and looked as if they wished they could join in, but at least they didn't. I had become interested in astronomy as a teenager, in particular at radio astronomy, looking at the radio wave emissions from stars and galaxies. And thought that this would make a wonderful branch of physics to move into. Snag is, it's not done in many places. There were only two places in Britain that did it, University of Manchester, University of Cambridge. And I applied to Manchester, but I had already been warned by some grad students there that they didn't think they'd take women. So when the university never bothered to acknowledge my application or tell me on what timescale there'd be a decision or anything, I decided this was their way of not taking a woman. And I was all set to go to Australia, which is another great centre for radio astronomy. But their academic year doesn't begin till January or February. And so I had a few months in hand, and I put in an application to the University of Cambridge just in case. Oxford and Cambridge are the really elite universities in Britain, and I knew I didn't stand a chance of getting in, but I thought I'd better do it, just, you know, kill a few months. And rather to my surprise, very much to my surprise, I got in. Oxford and Cambridge are both organised on a college system, and you have to be admitted by a college as well as the department. And at that time, out of 35 or 40 colleges, only three took women, and they were average size colleges. So women were in a very strong minority in Cambridge. Now both Oxford and Cambridge, I think all but one of their colleges are both sexes, and there's a lot more women around the place. So I find myself in Cambridge. Now here's a bit of British geography. I started life in Northern Ireland. I finished my schooling in York. I go to university in Glasgow, in Scotland. And suddenly, by mistake almost, I find myself in the deep south, in Cambridge. This you won't find on a map. I suspect there'll be similar gradients in every country, but definitely in the British Isles, the north and west is wild, uncouth, and ultimate civilization is in the southeast. So, as a kind of country yokel, I turn up in Cambridge, and they're all terribly clever. I'm quite keen to let you know it as well, some of them. And I think, whoa, I'm not that clever. They've made a mistake admitting me, and they're going to discover their mistake, and they're going to throw me out. This is what we now call imposter syndrome. I don't know if that's something that's common parlance over here. Okay, right. This wasn't defined in Britain at the time, but with hindsight, I can recognize it as classic imposter syndrome. And working now in Oxford University, it's one of the things you have to look out for. Kids from unaffluent backgrounds or rural backgrounds suddenly panicking and leaving. I wish I had known about this wonderful statement made by a Russian Zeldovich. Actually says of cosmologists, but could apply to anybody in Cambridge. Frequently in error, but never in doubt. Great posture. So I decided to work as hard as I could so that when they threw me out, I wouldn't have a guilty conscience. I'd know I'd done my best and I just wasn't clever enough for Cambridge. So this is a slight variant on imposter syndrome. So I was being crazily conscientious. We spent 2 years building the equipment, a radio telescope, in a field outside Cambridge. I was one of a group of six that built it. And then when it was built, at the beginning of my third year, the rest of the construction crew moved to other projects, and I became the grad student and the first person to operate this equipment, and to debug it, of course. And because I was being incredibly, really sickly thorough, I noticed an anomaly. There weren't many computers in those days. The university had one computer. It had less memory than your laptop, and obviously very few academics could have time on it. And the other academics just used their grad students, like we might use a computer today. And my data came out on strips of paper chart, rolls of paper chart. There was 5 kilometres, 3 miles of paper chart by the time I'd done my 6 months observing. And I quickly got to recognise the stuff I was meant to recognise, and also to recognise artificial interference, radio interference. Because you have, if you have a big sensitive radio telescope to pick up the weak cosmic signals, somebody with a mobile phone or a microwave oven nearby can blast everything. They're just so strong compared with the cosmic stuff. But there was about 5 millimetres of chart in the 120 metres it took to do a full sky survey that occasionally I couldn't diagnose. And I ultimately clicked that this half centimetre of stuff came, when it came, when we were always looking at the same bit of sky. So when we looked at that bit of sky, sometimes we saw this anomalous signal. A lot of times we didn't, but the next time we saw it was from the same bit of sky. And the next time we saw it, it was from the same bit of sky. So I picked up an anomaly that was 5 millimetres in 500 metres, or 1 part in 10 to the 5. That's how sick I was. And it was very unclear what this 5 millimetre signal was, which I discussed with my thesis advisor. And we decided on some special observations to blow it up, so to speak, expand it up. And I spent a month trying to get this expanded recording because it had gone away, whatever it was, this thing, and then finally got it. And very much to our surprise, this is the historic first record. There's 1 second time marks which were broadcast at that time in Britain, and we would put them on our chart recording. And this was the signal the telescope picked up. So you see pulse, 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 one missing, pulse, 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 2 or 3 missing, and back on beat. So even when the strength of the signal dropped for some reason, it kept beat, it kept phase. And we'd never seen anything like this. Never, ever. We didn't know such a thing could exist. And it was only because of the particular kit that I was using that we were able to pick it up. So we then had about 2 months of frantic activity trying to understand what this signal was. And we went through various phases. Can anybody guess what that stands for? Little green men. One possibility, pretty faint, but one possibility was it was extraterrestrials signaling to us. My thesis advisor, Tony, thought up quite a good test. Supposing this is a star out in space, and this is the little green men, and you are the observers. The little green men are orbiting their star, so it goes around like this, and it's going beep, 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 beep. By analogy, I'm a child playing, and I'm going, meow. What am I doing? What's this? Meow.
Car.
Racing car, probably. Note the change in pitch. Meow. It's what we call Doppler shift. As the car's coming towards you, the sound waves pile up on each other, higher pitch, lower pitch. Similar thing here. Little green men are coming towards you. Pulses pile up on each other. This is normal. Little green men going away from you, pulses get spread out. So I continued making observations, and we looked to see if we could find any change in the spacing of the pulses, which would indicate it was little green men or something going round a star. And we couldn't find any of that Doppler shift. So it was the star itself, not something orbiting a star. We managed to get an estimate of distance, about 200 light years, puts it beyond the solar system, but within our galaxy. And we managed to get an estimate of distance, which, yes, no, I said that. There was something else we managed to do. We got another radio telescope to go observe it, just in case Jocelyn had wired up this radio telescope wrong and it was producing some fluky result. But the other radio telescope with its own receiver also picked up these pulses. So it wasn't a fault with our piece of equipment. And yet it's moving with the stars. It's keeping its place amongst the stars. So it's not Joe Doak driving home from work in a badly suppressed car, because he's getting off work 4 minutes earlier each day. The stars get earlier each day. 4 minutes a day, 28 minutes a week. This has been going on for several months and nobody's noticed. It's not Joe Doak driving home from work in a badly suppressed car. And we'd reached a kind of crisis where we were saying, we're running out of tests to do on this data, and yet we really ought to be publishing it. How do you publish one curious, freakish, maybe even high-profile result when there's only one? And we didn't solve it that night, but later at night I came in to do some more of the routine chart analysis, you know, my 3 miles of chart paper, and looking at another part of the sky, technically a very difficult one, I thought I saw. Aha, wonder what that is. And what you do is you get out all the other charts that cover that strip of sky and look on them. And I could see that just occasionally there had been something there. That thing came through the telescope beam at 2 o'clock in the morning, and I was out there, and to my great joy in came pulse, 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 pulse. This time 1.25 seconds apart. The first one was 1.33. So it's the same kind of thing. It's in a totally different bit of sky. And it's not really going to be little green men, because there won't be two lots of little green men, opposite sides of the universe, both signaling to a rather inconspicuous planet Earth, using a technique that is technically daft. It has to be some kind of new category of stellar object. And that's what turned out to be the pulsars. So we now know, 50 years on, I'll start first with the video, because it's always the video that catches your eye. There is a star spinning. It's got two beams of radio waves, a bit like the beams from a lighthouse, that sweep round the sky as it spins about a vertical axis. And when one of the beams shines in our face, like now, you see a pulse. Usually we only see one of the beams. The thing is slightly canted. Don't think we've yet convinced ourselves for sure that we've seen one where we see both beams. Slightly more technically, on the right-hand side, here's the star spinning about a vertical axis. These beams come out of the magnetic poles of the star. It's got a phenomenally strong magnetic field, and somehow, we don't yet have it fully sussed, radio beams come out of those two positions and sweep around the sky. And like a lighthouse, if the beam shines in your face, you see the flash. So where a pulsar has a beam sweeping across the Earth, we see it as a pulsar. There will doubtless be some whose beams don't sweep across the Earth that we don't see. We probably only see about 1 in 5. So this was a very surprise discovery and a great sensation. There's now a number of groups worldwide working on these objects. We are gradually elucidating what they are, and they're extremely extreme, to pun a phrase. They're also known as neutron stars because they're rich in the nuclear particle neutrons. They're very small. They're like about 10 miles across. They're very dense because they weigh 1,000,000,000,000,000,000 tons. Something like the mass of the sun jammed into a ball 10 miles across, or 10 kilometers radius. And because there's that much mass, they've got very strong gravitational field. They also have very strong electrical and magnetic fields, and they spin rapidly. The cartoon was a moderately fast one, but there are some that spin 700 times a second. which, you know, if you listen to it, would sound like your kitchen blender. And there are some that pulso only about once every 3 seconds. And they're believed to be formed at the end of the life of a very big star, much bigger than our sun. The really big stars, The stars that you see shining in the sky are doing nuclear fusion reactions. They're converting hydrogen to helium. And that releases energy, which in the case of our sun comes out as sunlight. When a star runs out of hydrogen and has got too much helium, it can have the option of nuclear fusing the helium to make carbon. And that'll keep it shining a bit longer. And our sun will do that ultimately. For the majority of stars, including our sun, that's the end. They die. They run out of fuel and they stop shining. But if you have a really massive star, it can work itself on up the periodic table, getting as far as having iron in its core. And you cannot do a nuclear fusion reaction with iron. You can't do a nuclear fission one either, as a matter of interest. But with heavier elements, you can fission them and get energy out, atomic bomb. With lighter elements, you can fuse them and get energy out, hydrogen bomb. But ultimately, you end up with iron in the core, and that doesn't do any fusion. In fact, it's endothermic. It absorbs energy. And so this star with an iron core actually is trying to fission or fuse and produce energy. Go away. Updating. Oh, bless you. And the net result is the core shrinks and shrinks and shrinks. The material that was just outside the core finds it isn't standing on anything, goes whizzing down to get a foothold, hits something even more solid than a brick wall, rebounds, and there's a certain amount of neutrino production and things as well. You get a massive explosion. And the thing that was the center of the star collapses under the explosion and ends up as one of these pulsars, 10 miles across and weighing 1,000 million tons. So that's how they end. Now, I got engaged to be married between discovering pulsars numbers 2 and 3, wore my engagement ring into the lab because I was terribly proud of it, but it was an exceedingly stupid thing to do because it signaled that I was quitting. Married women didn't work. It was shameful if a married woman had to work. It meant he couldn't earn enough. And once there were children, it was proven, you could hear experts on the radio telling you, it was proven that if mothers worked, the kids would be delinquent. So whenever I have a class of students or school kids, I ask how many of their mothers work, and all the hands go up, and I ask how many of them are delinquent. And there's always one on the back row who puts up their hand. But absolute rubbish. But, you know, it was proven. So there weren't childminding facilities. It was extremely difficult to keep going. I remember one of my neighbours saying, you got a husband, a new baby and a new house, and you say you're bored. What's wrong with you? It's a little sharp. I think what was going on there, or at least this is my reading of it, is that she had, without thinking it through, become a wife and mother. And my wanting to work had actually challenged her non-decision or drifting into motherhood and wifehood. And maybe she was a very intelligent woman. She could have held down a very good job, and maybe I was unsettling her and she realized that maybe she could have done some work. But certainly I think my generation has been at the turning point in Britain in terms of women working. So this is an electromagnetic spectrum which you don't need, thanks Bev, which you don't need explaining to you. This is the visual bit that we can see. I showed this slide once after I'd been to a management training course where we learnt correct language. I think we are electromagnetically challenged, folks, because we can't see that part of the spectrum out to gamma rays, and we can't see this bit of the spectrum down to radio waves. Well, I did my PhD in that. I was moving around with my husband, so I worked in gamma rays next. And then he moved jobs, so I worked in X-rays. And then he moved jobs, so I worked in infrared. And then I worked in millimeter. And then the marriage broke up and the kid went to university. And suddenly I was free to go after a job because of what it was, not where it was. But I've been a researcher, a university lecturer, a tutor, a manager, a professor, a head of department, a dean, and I've done PR and outreach. But if I'm really honest, that's my career. You go to an organization, you work your way up it. Husband says it's time to move. You start at the bottom of an organization, you work your way up it. Husband says it's time to move. Proper word these days is portfolio career, isn't it? If you gloss it a bit. I was lucky. I knew from my teenage years that I wanted to be an astronomer, preferably a radio astronomer. And that helped me to be persistent through university and so on. But one of the consequences of having to move around a lot is I've had to take risks. And I surprised myself by discovering that actually I liked managing groups of people. I liked teaching. I liked research, perhaps goes without saying. I really enjoyed the outreach work. And if I'd had an orthodox career, might not have had that. I've also learned that one failure doesn't make a disaster. Einstein had some early failures and didn't stop him. To aim as high as I could, but wherever possible to keep options open, because likely I would have to change again at some point. So to change tack slightly, there is an international body for professional astronomers, the International Astronomical Union. It has elected officers. It runs mega meetings every 3 years. We've just met in Vienna in Austria this summer. And going back about 15 years, I guess, the general secretary, who was responsible for membership, because you can be an individual member of this organization as well as your country belonging. The then secretary, a man from Denmark, an astronomer, married to an astronomer, became very concerned about the trouble his wife was having getting a job in Denmark as an astrophysicist. And he thought, I wonder if it's the same in other countries. So he looked at the membership data for the International Astronomical Union and he broke it up by gender. And the International Astronomical Union has continued doing that ever since. And it's a fantastic database on women in astronomy, women in professional astronomy worldwide. Now, I hope you can see some of these figures. This is from about April or May this year. And what I'm looking at is the percentage of astronomers who are female. And I'm only looking at countries with more than 200 astronomers so that the root N errors aren't too big. The world average is 17%. That's a little bit on the low side because you have to be more than a graduate student to be an individual member. You have to be not exactly tenured, but probably tenured or tenurable. So it's a bit artificially suppressed because there's more women in amongst younger astronomers. So world average 17%. Southern European countries doing very well. South America doing very well. Russia, yeah, but Russia has a special history. It lost a lot of men after one of the world wars and a flu epidemic. So for decades, the women have had to go out to work and the state provides nursery care for kids. Those are all above the world average. Then the English-speaking countries, ourselves included, cluster a little bit below the world average. China's probably a one-off. Here come the northern European countries, and India and Japan, perhaps no surprises there. There's quite a range. What's quite interesting is that these are Catholic countries, and these ones tend to be Protestant countries. Not quite what I would have guessed at first thought, but that's the way it is. But above all, there's quite a bit of variability between 26% and 7%. And the most important message this gives me is that these are cultural factors. It's nothing to do with women's brains, because I don't believe that Italian women's brains are significantly different from women's brains here, for example. This is the influence of society and culture and what's considered proper or normal for women, and maybe what's considered prestigious for men. There are a few caveats. I've talked about you're supposed to be tenured or close to tenure. You have to be nominated by the professional astronomy body in your country. The gender balance of that group is probably male-dominated, so it's perhaps not surprising that you perhaps get more men nominated than women, disproportionately more. That's the IAU website if anybody wants to dig into this further. And so, as I've already said, Latin America, Southern Europe, high in female. Northern Europe and the English-speaking countries, low percentage female. The limiting factor is culture. And although I don't think there are quite the same databases, I'm told that there are similar distributions for physics and for maths. I haven't asked about other science subjects. So today in the UK, women in science, it's getting better. There are more women in undergraduate. It's getting better there faster. But there still are issues around work life, family, career. And there are more subtle issues about the climate in a physics department or any workplace that we haven't fully addressed or even sussed out. This is actually Scottish data. We're currently redoing it, but 5 years on, but I haven't got the up-to-date data. It won't have changed much. This is about 15 or 16-year-olds in school. This is school leaving, undergraduate, postgraduate, researchers, assistant, associate, and full professor. The red is biology. Lots of girls in school biology classes. By the time you get to the professoriate, it's way, way down. The blue is chemistry. The black is mathematics. The green is physics. Ignore the yellow line. We didn't have the data quite right for that. And this lilac is engineering, which is not taught in British schools. So it only starts at the undergraduate level. And they all drop. And people used to say, well, we just have to wait for this cohort to work through and we'll have lots of female professors. But it doesn't work through. It stays persistently like this, this kind of shape. The numbers may change a bit, but it stays. This is the growth. This is the growth in the proportion of academic staff that are female over a 6-year period. And the growth is glacial. Slightly different colourings. The top one is biosciences, so they do have more female professors, for instance. Chemistry, maths, physics, and electrical, electronic, and computer engineering. So don't hold your breath. It's going to take a long time. There are, however, been some initiatives in the UK, and I was involved in one of them, which I'll... How am I doing for time? Good, okay. We're collecting data. It's always a good start. It's disaggregated by gender, which is even better. So we can now see how many men and women there are at each level. And surprise, surprise, it shows women are in a minority, and that the minority gets smaller, the number gets smaller, the higher you go up the academic hierarchy. It also shows that women progress more slowly than their male counterparts. And it shows that women put in fewer grant applications for smaller amounts of money. And if they're unsuccessful, they wait longer before putting in another grant application. That they're less willing to apply for jobs, they're less willing to apply for promotion. So, solution's easy, isn't it? Fix the women. And we went through a phase where we said, we must fix the women. We must make the women braver, write better applications, have a better curriculum vitae. And we, for a while, ran special training courses to help women address these deficiencies. But the assumption was the problem was the women. And the other assumption was that the way scientific society, academic scientific society works is perfectly okay. No problems there. It's just the women. So fix the women. Another thing we tried doing was having special fellowships, particularly for women who were coming back from maternity leave or some career break for some other reason. And the women who got those faced criticism along the lines of, you only got that funding because you're a woman. You're not up to the standard in this department. You're pulling us down. You should leave. Which has been said. I hope it's no longer said. So increasingly, we've learnt not to have women-only things, but to have things that are open to both males and females. And some men do take career breaks. So we can have career break or post-career break fellowships, but they're open to men and women, so the women don't face that criticism. So, various other things. They finally discovered that giving fellowships or support to individual women was great for the individual women, but they came and they went, and the university went on exactly the same. There was no change. And gradually the funding agencies began to recognize that what they needed to do was to change the climate in a number of institutions to make it fairer for everybody. You know, people with disabilities were a bit discriminated against. There was some racial discrimination. So somehow we had to make the universities a fairer place for all. And I became involved in something called, well, involved, I helped create an Athena Swan Award. We started this probably 30 years ago. A very small group of senior women scientists, or moderately senior women scientists, meeting after work at our own expense in a borrowed room to think what we could do to improve the situation, particularly for women in science, engineering, and technology. And we tried various things, and then one of us, who was a bit of a psychologist, I think, suddenly said, you know, vice-chancellors, that's what we call the presidents of universities in Britain, vice-chancellors are competitive guys, and they were all guys at that point. If we create some prize to show that they're a woman-friendly place, they'll compete. Well, we didn't have very much money. The only thing we could afford was a glass rose bowl. But we advertised this competition, and they competed. And for several years, we were awarding a glass rose bowl to the university that demonstrated itself to be the most woman-friendly. And finally, this caught on. And some of the funding bodies got in on the act, almost by accident. It's scary how some of these things happen. The chief medical officer for England and Wales holds funds for medical research in English and Welsh universities. And one day, the current chief medical officer was meeting with the heads of medical schools to talk about the kind of things you talk about with a funder. The chief medical officer is a woman. The heads of the medical schools were all men. And at the end of their discussion, She said, "And where are the women?" And the men said, "Oh." And she had, as she describes it, a rush of blood to the head, and said, "Any of you who want my funding must hold an Athena Swan Award by the end of next year," which is pretty scary. So we now have this Athena Swan Award in three grades, bronze, silver, gold. It lasts for 3 years. You then have to reapply. You're required to collect your statistics, look at your statistics, see what you could do to improve your statistics, suggest what you will actually do in the next 3 years, and then it's judged by an overworked panel. The funding agencies have caught on to this in a big way. And not only do the medical people require it, but now other funding agencies do. It's been extended to the arts, humanities and social sciences, as well as sciences, where the issue often is they have more women than men in some of those areas. And it has been exported to Ireland, to Australia, and I've just heard it's going to Canada. The Irish one is quite scary, actually. You can hold it as a university's central administration, but individual departments can also hold it. The Irish funding agency has said if a university doesn't hold Athena Swan Bronze by 2019, none of the departments will be able to apply for funding. And if they don't hold silver by something like 2022, none of the departments. And by gum, when a funding agency starts saying that kind of thing, people take notice. So I'm waiting for the pushback, I have to say, but it hasn't happened yet. So some examples of the institutional change that we've been hoping to bring about. Some really a collection of miscellaneous remarks. You can have a college, a university made up of individuals who are individually not discriminating, but the systems in that place can be, the systems and the structures. That's called institutional sexism. And it shows up as possible biases in recruitment or retention. It shows up as an unawareness of different management styles. You know, everybody must have a macho management style. It also shows up in unconscious bias that's not dealt with. Now, is unconscious bias something you're aware of? Yes, I think you are. Okay. My favourite example of unconscious bias, which we have yet to get corrected. Have you had to fill in a form where you tick a box saying which sex or gender you are? Which box comes first? Alphabetical order? Historic reasons? This suddenly hit me one day when something at the back of my brain said, I'm tired of ticking the second box. Why can't I tick the first box? And then I looked and saw. It's a hangover from yonks, but it's still there. And I don't think I've got many organizations to change the order yet. This is my favorite quote from a Harvard professor. You probably gathered by now I'm not a well-behaved woman. But whether I've made history is a... So, by popular request, i.e. one person, I'm including...